More to me. your name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Amen. So we're praising him for that. Man. Well, we need a new touch of the Lord. We do. Each one of us. We need to draw closer to the Lord. We can't get saved any more than we are. Once you're saved, you're saved. But we can draw closer because the scripture says they are deeper depths and higher heights with God. We don't have to just stay at the same level. We can climb that spiritual ladder in our life, and we should strive to do that. Strive to enter in. Strive, amen, to be closer to the Lord. I'm going to read some scripture out of the book of Isaiah, which are familiar scriptures, the 53rd chapter of Isaiah. And it talks about the suffering that Jesus went through in order to redeem our souls, in order to heal our bodies. You know, Jesus didn't just get whipped to be whipped. You know, about, as a matter of fact, he was innocent. There was no sin in Jesus. He was perfect, and he was a perfect man. No sin. He didn't become a sinner when he died on that cross like some doctrines teach today. He became the deliverer, the salvation to us to give us eternal life. So he was a sacrificial lamb. You know, we go back into the Old Testament, we can read where they had taken an animal, a lamb or a bullock or whatever they offered to God at that time. That animal never had sin in its life. It didn't know what sin was. It was innocent, just like Jesus was. He was innocent, but he came like he was led like a sheep to the slaughter, dumb before his ears. He opened not his mouth. He went and he laid down his life for the sins of the whole world. But let's read, see what we can get out of the Word of God tonight. The 53rd chapter of Isaiah says, "Who hath believed our report?" First verse. "And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him." You know, I believe that Jesus was a handsome man until they beat his face like there was 100 soldiers when he was in Pilate's judgment hall, came and they put a bag over his head, I guess, and smacked him in the face and said, "Prophesy unto us and tell us who it is that hit you." Jesus could have done that. He could have said, well, the name and everything. He knew everything. Isn't it right? God knows everything. He knew who it was. But he was like that. His face was beaten so bad that he wasn't a man to be looked upon or be desired. And there was no beauty in that. Was no beauty in the crucifixion. It was a gruesome thing that Jesus suffered and went through. All the stripes that he had borne for our deliverance, now for our healing. That's the reason each stripe represents a healing for our bodies. Each one, it was 39. They say it was 39 stripes. It could have been more because the Romans, you know, the 39 stripes was a Jewish rule, but the Romans didn't have no rule. They could beat you as often as they wanted it. And you know, it was just the Lord. It was God that kept his hand upon his son that he didn't die before Calvary, before he went to the cross, because of the pain and the suffering that he went through. Know that, you know, when a person gets weak and they lose a lot of blood, they begin to get weak. And that's the way Jesus was. He got weak and he began to fall beneath the load of the cross. But anyway, he held on. They had a man by the name of Simon of Cyrene to go ahead to carry the cross on up to Calvary's hill for him, because they seen that he was getting too weak, or he began to fall beneath the loads of the cross. But they had a man that was a Simon of Cyrene, which was a Gentile, to come and lift up the cross and to carry it on up to Calvary's hill. Help Jesus out. He helped him out, didn't he? I believe Jesus still carried the cross, but he helped him carry it. And I praise God for that. But as I said, them stripes that he had taken in Pilate's judgment hall was for our healing and for our deliverance or whatever disease. And they say there's 39 major diseases in the world, and each stripe represented a major disease. So Jesus did that for us. But the beating that they had taken, think about that. They planted that crown of thorns in his head, and those thorns was about at least 6 inches long, and they weren't little thorns like on roses. These thorns went into the flesh and into the skull as they planted it on. As a matter of fact, they took and beat that thing on his head. And you know, amen, that he lost a lot of blood through that. But as I said, there was no beauty in him that they should desire him. But yeah, I believe that when he had all that suffering, he was despised and rejected of men. And I believe he is today. A lot of people don't like Jesus. They hate him. They do. They hate Jesus. They hate anybody that's got to do with Christianity. They hate you because you believe in Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord of your life. But I know one, at the end of the road, they're going to meet God. Every human being from Adam all the way through is going to meet God one day and give an account of their life. Man, there's not going to be no excuse. They're not going to be arguing with God, like I said earlier. They're not going to be able to argue and say, well, God, I didn't know. No excuse. He's still despised. He said he's despised and rejected of men, especially the Pharisees and the scribes and those in that time under, what was it, Herod, especially at that time. He was despised, rejected of men, didn't want to hear anything. You know, he preached in the synagogue every Sabbath day, which was Saturday. That's the Jewish Sabbath. Every Sabbath day, he went in and he read the scriptures and read the law and so forth. And they didn't even bother him. They didn't touch him. They listened to what he had to say. But you know, when the devil gets mad and he gets upset, they're going to do everything. It's going to do everything he can to try to hinder you, try to destroy you. You know, he's a thief. He comes to kill, to steal, and destroy. But Jesus said, I come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. Now, I want abundant life, don't you? I want what God has for me. I know we have to pay a price for the, there's nothing though that we can do to gain God's favor in order to get closer to the Lord. We just have to surrender our all over to God. You know, people are trying to work their salvation. You can't work it. It's not of works. It's not, I said salvation's not of works. It's by faith that we trust the Lord for what he had done 2,000 years ago. We put our faith in him tonight and today that Jesus is the Lord of our life. And so we're trusting him to help us through our Christian life. I know we're going to be afflicted and tested. We're going to be tested and tried, but that's according to God's word. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers us out of all of them. Every one of them. Even if we get afflicted, persecution. Jesus said, if they persecute me, you know they're going to persecute you because we are not no better than our Lord. How many knew that? Persecution, as I said this morning, just draws us closer to the cross. It draws us nearer to God as we're being persecuted for our faith. They call us fanatics. They call us all kinds of names. But praise God, we got our faith is in the Lord. We're not going to let that bother us. We're going to keep the faith, and we're going to go put our face toward the prize of the higher calling, which is in Christ Jesus, and we're going to make heaven our home. Praise the Lord. If you believe it, say amen. Amen. But see, as I said, those Pharisees, the scribes, they didn't care much for Jesus after a while when he was winning people into the kingdom. He was out doing miracles. He was healing the sick, casting out devils, even raised the dead, I believe. He was doing great things, feeding the 5,000 people with five loaves of bread, as they sang this morning. Man, God was just anointing Jesus. And you know, Jesus didn't do no miracles until he was 30 years old. And matter of fact, he said he didn't do any miracles at all, except his God, his Father would direct him and would lead him. Isn't that right? And God led him to a lot of many miracles that were being performed. Souls were being delivered. I don't know how they were saved back then, but I mean, it was by faith. I guess it was the same way it is today. It's by faith, believing that Jesus Christ is Savior and Lord. You know, and Jesus says, you believe that I'm able to heal you, like the two blind men that came to Jesus, and they wanted their healing, and Jesus asked them, what can I do for you? He said, well, we're blind. We need our eyesight. We need to see. And Jesus said, do you believe that I'm able to do this? And they said, yes, Lord. And it was many times Jesus prayed for people in that day, and Jesus seen their faith. See, and that's what the Lord's looking for tonight. He's looking for your faith to work. And faith does work. How many know that? Faith will reach out and touch the Lord and touch the throne of God. Faith will believe God for things that seems impossible with us. It's not impossible with the Lord. Amen? You know, Jesus told him that. Says, things that seems impossible with man, it's not impossible with God. God can do anything but fail. He's my Savior, my healer, my Lord, and my God. And I believe that we need to get stirred up and revived in our spirits. And you know, how many knows what we need is revival. We need a revival. It's hard in this day and hour to have a revival. We used to have revivals weeks on at a time, even maybe 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks. Some went up to 6 weeks. Brother Hardy had it in Baltimore for 10 years. Every service, every week, every night, usually he had church, maybe one night out of the week that he didn't have church, but every night for 10 years he had revival. People got touched. People got blessed. People come for miracles. I've seen miracles happen. I've seen people with blindness be healed. I've seen people lame, crippled. God healed them. And God's no respecter of person. What he done back then, he's still able to do it today. It just had to put our faith in the action, so to speak, and begin to believe that God will do it for us. See, if you're a child of God, just like you, your parents, you have a child that needs a healing, you want to help them and do the best that you can for them. Man, you'll probably travel many miles if you had to get that child touched and get that child healed. But we need to have our faith and our trust maybe more in the Lord tonight and trust God for the healing and deliverance in our lives, in our bodies. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He never changes. We change. We change. We let down on God. Man, we don't want to do that. We don't want to let down, but let's keep pressing in there. Keep pressing on. Let's keep believing God can do the exceedingly abundantly above all that we may ask or think according to the power that works whereat in us, in you. You got the power in the name of Jesus. We need to use it for his glory. I know sometimes people say, well, now you're getting old and your faith, you just can't get everything like you did when you were younger. But God hasn't changed. He's still the same. He's still the same. Praise God. But people today are rejecting Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. You'd be surprised of the people in America now, just in America, that's not believing in the Word of God. Man, they say that the church, they're trying to say the church today is a terrorist group. We're not terrorists. We love people. I love to see people saved and delivered. That's what God saves us for. There's so many out there today that are on drugs and alcohol and all the other lustful things that they got in the world, and they need deliverance. Maybe they're in it because of ignorance. I don't know, because they don't know no better. But once they hear the gospel preached, there's no excuse, no reason why they can't give up sin and give up the world for Jesus. And Jesus tells us that if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, follow me daily, he said, every day. You know, that's what we're failing, maybe in a way. We're not following him every day. We're not walking in the light of the Lord every day like we should as Christians. We should do that every day. Like the song said, every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus, I love him more and more. And I tell you, I'm getting to feel him right now in my heart, my spirit. And I'm just praying that God will touch you and encourage you to get you all excited, and that you want to tell everybody that Jesus Christ is Lord, the King of Kings. Amen. So Jesus did this for you and for me and for the whole world. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. See, I want to have everlasting life with the Lord, don't you? Praise God, I want to see him move in this hour and this day that we're living in. See, nothing is impossible with the Lord. All things are possible to them that believe. Doesn't make any difference. It might seem like it's impossible for you, but God can do anything. God's got a whole storehouse of blessings up there in heaven for you. If you just seek his face, call his name. We need to draw closer to him, don't we? Nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. It all comes through faith and trusting in the Lord. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly, the scripture says. Praise God. Let me read that third verse again in the scripture. He was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. We hid as it was our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Oh, praise the Lord. He did it for you. He did it for me. Yes, he did it for me. Praise God. And he says in the fifth verse, and he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. Isn't that a great thought? Every stripe, like I said, is for our healing and for our deliverance. You know, we don't hear a whole lot of preaching. There's a lot of preaching on salvation, which is the greatest thing that can happen to anyone, is for them to get saved and get ready to meet God. But you hardly ever see them or hear them preaching on the healing power of God, which should be in us. God's greater in you than he that's within the world. He's your healer. He can do anything. Most of you can probably testify of God's touch. How that he touched you. How that he's healed your body. And that's what you should do. Testify and tell people that Jesus done what he had done for you to heal your body. Give them, amen, give all the praise and all the glory to him, though. Don't take no credit for yourself. Take all the glory to God. I know sometimes people tell me, Brother Belt, you preached a good sermon this morning. I say, well, give God all the glory, because I couldn't do it without his anointing, without his spirit, without the word. I couldn't preach the word, but I tell you, I'm glad I can do it. And if it's an inspiration and encouragement to some people, I'll be glad to preach it and tell people about the saving grace of God, the healing power of the Lord. But I do like this scripture, and it is quoted many times, where he says, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. You know, sometimes you think back, you know, if you can take your mind back into the Pilate Judgment Hall and see them beating them. We've seen that one film that they made a few years back about where Jesus was beaten so bad. You know, sometimes you see a Christian movie on TV and you seen like maybe a little bit of blood on where they had beat the Lord, but nothing compared to that one. Amen. I forget what the name of the story was, but passion, that's right, the passion of Christ, and the suffering that he went through. But you know, even that, I believe it's nothing to be compared to what Jesus really went through. Can you imagine that? All of his disciples that was with him as he ministered for all them years, 3.5 years, I believe it was, all them years that he ministered, they were with him. But when it come down to the end where he was going to be killed and be crucified, they fled, left him. The only one that was there that followed him was Peter, and he followed him away off, far off. Man, he followed him a distance away because he didn't want to be around him because he was afraid probably that he would die as well and be crucified, which he did. They did crucify him according to the history of it, that Peter was crucified upside down because he said, I don't want to be crucified by my Lord like my Lord was. Just turn me upside down. And they crucified him upside down. All the disciples and apostles that was with Jesus died because they would not deny their faith in the Lord. The song says, I will not be denied. I will not be denied till Jesus came and made me whole. I will not be denied. And we can't deny our faith. Amen. Some of them can't come to Peter and say, well, you're one of those. You're one of those disciples, aren't you? Oh, no, not me. I don't know the man. See how easy it is? I know some people say, well, I love God with all my heart. But when it comes down to really, maybe you might have to suffer a little bit. Do we really love him like we say we love him? Will we? Do we? Praise God, Jesus paid a great price in order to redeem us. We should be bold. You know, Peter was kind of backwards at first, but when he got the baptism of the Holy Ghost, he was bold. He stood up. Man wasn't afraid to preach or testify or whatever it was to the power of God. God worked miracles through them. God worked through Peter and James and John and the other apostles. He worked through them that souls were saved and delivered and set free. Healings took place because they had faith and they believed what God's words. You know, they were eyewitnesses to the fact that Jesus did resurrect from the dead. I've never seen Jesus like they did. I've never seen him like that. But praise God, they had enough witnessed right there to suffer and die for their faith. If we had something like that, we would, you know, we'd hold on to the end, wouldn't we? But Jesus suffered and died in order to give us eternal life. He's the way, the truth, and the life. Praise God. And he says in the next verse, he said, And all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquities of us all. He took all of our sins. He took all of our sin, not part of them, all of them. And praise God, we can say we're sin-free. Now we can sin if we want to, but I don't want to. Man, I said I don't want to because he took away my sins. I want to serve him. I know we get tempted. Everybody gets tempted to do something wrong. We don't want to do nothing like that because we know what the Lord has brought us from and where we could have been. Praise God. You know, I never thought about hell or anything like that when I was in sin, but God opened my eyes and my understanding let me realize there was a place called hell. Jesus preached on it, and you know, you don't hear too many preachers preaching on it anymore. Man, they said it scares people, but I'll tell you one thing, we need to scare them so they won't have to go to that place. And I heard some preachers say the word, but I'm not going to say the word. Amen. Praise God. But we don't want to see nobody die and go into a devil's hell. But people from, like I said, from Adam all the way to Christ, from Christ all the way to this generation, people without God, didn't have Jesus in their life. I hope and pray, it don't say nowhere in the Bible where Adam and Eve ever repented and got right with the Lord. I don't know if they're going to make it in or not, but I tell you one thing, we need to make up our mind. We're going to make it in. I don't want nothing here to hinder me, because someday, glad day, his blessed face I long to see. I want to see him in all of his glory. Praise God. I believe there's deeper depths, higher heights, and we need to pray till the power of the Lord comes down. We need to worship God until the glory of God shakes our spirits and gets us on fire for him. We need to do that for his glory. Thank you, Jesus. I'm glad I'm saved tonight. If you're saved, give the Lord a great big clap offering. Hallelujah. I'm on my way to glory land. Clean.
Glory, hallelujah. I shall not be moved. Anchored in Jehovah. I shall not be moved. Just like a tree planted by the waters, I shall not be moved. In his love abiding, I shall not be moved. And in his confiding, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree planted by the waters, I shall not be moved. I shall not be, I shall not be moved. I shall not be, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree planted by the waters, I shall not be Jesus will not fail me. I shall not be moved. Just like a tree planted by the waters, I shall not be moved. Though the tempest rages, I shall not be moved. On the rock of ages, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree planted by the waters, I shall not. I shall not be moved.